The importance of social atmosphere is evident in the thought and action of every individual. The character of the culture and the atmosphere of the family mold the personality of the growing child. The atmosphere in the classroom and workshop deeply affect the character of the work. The purpose of this experimental study, undertaken by Ronald Lippitt, was to test the effect of group atmosphere on the conditions which would permit insight into the underlying forces. Four boys' clubs were formed from different classes. From eager volunteers, five members were selected for each club so that the pattern of friendship and leadership was about the same for each club. These boys were 10 to 11 years old. They met 1 hour every week with their adult leader. Three distinct social climates were created. The first of these was democratic. In the democratic atmosphere, there was group planning and adult cooperation. The children were free to choose what to do and with whom to work, but the planning was done cooperatively and by majority decision. The second social climate was one of autocracy. In the autocratic atmosphere, the direction was entirely in the hands of the adult. He determined what was to be done and which children should work together. There was no long-range planning. The children were instructed from step to step in a friendly but determined manner. In the third group, an atmosphere of laissez-faire prevailed. In the laissez-faire atmosphere, there was individualistic freedom with a minimum of adult participation. These unrehearsed motion pictures document the activities of the clubs and are offered as illustration, not as scientific proof. The Democratic Club called itself the Dick Tracy Club and made a coat of arms. Most of the boys are sitting together discussing what to do today. Various suggestions are made. Different long-range plans are discussed in detail. The boy on the left is engaged in a specific project, but when the group votes, he is asked to give his consent. The two boys at the right have started a friendly scuffle, which breaks up quickly. A certain amount of horseplay is typical for the healthy child of that age. The boys have voted to make plaster footprints, and all have volunteered for their feet cast. Now they're all busy. The boy in the middle has just made a cast of his foot. Everyone is interested and active. The boy at the left is still sawing, and in the background, three boys and the leader work as a group. The democratic leader participates as a regular fella. He gladly gives technical advice, but only if asked. He carefully avoids any domineering behavior. At the right, a boy is mixing. The boy at the left is sawing. The boy in black in the rear is also sawing, and you'll notice he's very persistent. Work proceeds with much spontaneity. Small groups emerge. But working alone or in teams, the spirit of cooperation is maintained. Ideas are exchanged freely. When the leader leaves to test whether his presence affects their behavior, these democratic boys continue their work without loss of interest. At the end of the hour, everybody, including the leader, participates spontaneously in the cleanup. As our autocratic club, we present the secret agents, number 52. In this autocratic atmosphere, the boys reacted in two ways, either by aggression or by obedient submission. In the first place, the boys were somewhat rebellious against their leader, and showed much aggression against their fellows. On several occasions, one boy was made the scapegoat and the butt of much hostility. In other groups, the same degree of autocracy led to obedient submission, a kind of apathy. The secret agents show the typical characteristic of the submissive reaction to autocracy. This is the beginning of a meeting. Dependent and lacking in self-direction, the boys sit around, idle, waiting for their leader to arrive and direct their activities. The leader arrives and immediately starts to direct. The boys follow orders without discussion. The leader supervises but does not participate. He stands over the group. The boy at the right needs help with his apron. The autocrat does not give assistance, but orders another boy to fix the apron. The leader sees to it that every detail is carried out correctly. Soon, everybody is busy carrying out directions. Work proceeds as intensively as in democracy, but the product frequently shows a poorer quality. Note the complete lack of conversation among the boys. They communicate only with the leader, and if they wish advice, they ask him. The boy in the foreground has directed his attention elsewhere, but the autocrat orders him back to work. Everybody is told step by step what to do and with whom to work. This might look like a model schoolroom, but you'll now see what lies beneath the surface. The leader will leave the room for a short time to determine to what extent the behavior of the boys is the result of his presence. You'll remember that in democracy, the work went on as intensively as ever. In autocracy, work continues for a few moments, but the two boys at the left already have stopped work. By now, the work has disintegrated entirely. The boys are moving around aimlessly. Some are yelling, others are idle. This shows that work in autocracy is not child-driven activity. The boy at the left hears the leader returning, feels guilty, and acts as if he's been working. One boy after another quickly returns to his job, and soon all are again down to work. Under autocracy, cleanup at the end of the hour is typically thorough and painstaking. Each boy gets a specific task and is rigidly supervised. The Law and Order Patrol number 10 is our example of the third social atmosphere, that of laissez-faire. In a laissez-faire situation, everybody does only what he wants to do. The adult in the background stands aloof. He's ready to serve as a technical expert if asked, but he doesn't participate in the activity of the boys as the democratic leader did. He has little effect on the atmosphere. The boys have started with the material available. One boy approaches the leader for advice. Two other boys join him. A cooperative activity seems to emerge. The boy at the front and the boy at the right rush toward the group in the back. However, the cooperative work quickly disintegrates. The cooperative beginning lacked sufficient momentum to bring about group planning and group decision. Without these, the work disintegrates into individual projects, which frequently interfere with each other. The behavior of some of the boys is rather aimless. The older boy at the right in the rear keeps working, but the rest of the boys start some gunplay. They're shooting with wooden pistols from behind the burlap. The scene gets more and more lively. Anarchic freedom can also lead to boredom. The boy at the left doesn't know exactly what to do. The boy coming from the right is also somewhat at a loss. He looks around and seems to be completely bored. The laissez-faire situation turns out to be narrow and frustrating because it fails to provide worthwhile aims and long-range perspective. At the end of the hour, the boys go away unconcerned about the things they leave behind. Only Bob, the work-minded boy, plies on without help. Our statistical results for these groups show that friendly behavior and we feeling are greatest in democracy, least in aggressive autocracy. Aggression and ego-centered behavior among children are medium in democracy and laissez-faire. Very high in aggressive autocracy, and abnormally low in apathetic autocracy. Time spent in work is kept high by the leader in apathetic and aggressive autocracy. When the leader leaves, work drops. Instead, loafing becomes dominant. In democracy, the children continue to work on the same level. In laissez-faire, work-mindedness is usually low. In the first club meeting, the amount of hostility among children is about the same in the democratic and autocratic clubs. Later on, hostility in autocracy keeps well above hostility in democracy. At the fourth and fifth meetings of autocracy, the children, too weak to attack the leader, gang together against Tom, and he quits. At the sixth, seventh, and eighth meetings, George is made the scapegoat until he quits. Scapegoat outbursts never occurred.